Class 10, Unit 2, Prose, The Night the Ghost Got In, James Grover Thruber. Imagination of odd things always leads to absolute humor. The ghost that got into our house on the night of November 17, 1915, raised such a hullabaloo of misunderstandings that I'm sorry. I didn't just let it keep on walking and go to bed. Its advent caused my mother to throw a shoe through a window of the house next door and ended up with my grandfather shooting a patrolman. I'm sorry. Therefore, as I have said, that I never paid any attention to the footsteps. They began about a 1:15 in the morning. A rhythmic, quick, cadescent walking around the dining room table. My mother was asleep in one room upstairs. My brother Herman in another. Grandfather was in the attic, in the old walnut bed, which, as you will remember, once fell on my father. I had just stepped out of the bathtub and was busily rubbing myself with the towel. When I heard the steps, they were the steps of a man walking rapidly around the dining table downstairs. The light from the bathroom shone down the back steps, which dropped directly into the dining room. I could see the faint shine of plates on the plate rail. I couldn't see the table. The steps kept going round and round the table. At regular intervals, a board creaked when it was trod upon. I supposed at first that it was my father or my brother Roy, who had gone to Indianapolis but were expected home at any time. I suspected next that it was a burglar. It did not enter my mind until later that it was a ghost. After that walking had gone on for perhaps 3 minutes, I tiptoed to Herman's room. Psst! I hissed in the dark, shaking him. "Up," he said, in a low tone of a despondent bugle. He always half suspected that something would get him in the night. I told him who I was. "There is something downstairs," I said. He got up and followed me to the head of the back stairs. The steps had ceased. Herman looked at me in some alarm. I had only the bath towel around my waist. He wanted to go back to bed. I gripped his arm. "There is something down there," I said instantly. The steps began again, circled the dining room table like a man running, and startled up the steps towards us heavily, two at a time. The light still shone palely down the stairs. We saw nothing coming. We only heard the steps. Herman rushed to the room and slammed the door. I slammed shut the door at the stairs top and held my knee against it. After a long minute, I slowly opened it again. There was nothing there. There was no sound. None of us ever heard the ghost again. The slamming of the doors had aroused Mother. She peered out of her room. "What on earth are you boys doing?" she demanded. Herman ventured out of his room. "Nothing," he said gruffly, but he was in color a light green. what was all that running around downstairs? Said mother. So she had heard the steps too. We just looked at her. Burglars! She shouted. Intuitively, I tried to quieten her by startling lightly downstairs. Come on, Herman, I said. I'll stay with mother, he said. She's all excited. I stepped back onto the landing. Don't either of you go a step, said mother. We'll call the police. Since the phone was downstairs, I didn't see how we were going to call the police. Nor did I want the police. But mother made one of her quick, incomparable decisions. She flung up a window of her bedroom, which faced the bedroom windows of the house of a neighbor, picked up a shoe and whammed it through a pane of glass across a narrow space that separated the two houses. Glass tinkled into the bedroom occupied by a retired engraver named Bodwell and his wife. Bodwell had been for some years in rather a bad way and was subject to mild attacks. Almost everybody we knew or lived near had some kind of attacks. It was now about 2 o'clock of a moonless night. Clouds hung black and low. Bodwell was at the window in a minute, shouting, farting a little, shaking his fist. We'll sell the house and go back to Peoria. We could hear Mrs. Bodwell saying. It was some time before mother got through to Bodwell. Burglars! She shouted. Burglars in the house! Herman and I hadn't dared to tell her that it wasn't burglars, but ghosts. For she was even more afraid of ghosts than of burglars. Bodwell at first thought that she meant there were burglars in the house, but finally he quietened down and called the police for over an extension phone by his head. After he had disappeared from the window, mother suddenly made as if to throw another shoe. Not because there were further need of it, but as she later explained, because the thrill of heaving a shoe through a window glass had enormously taken her fancy, I prevented her. The police were on hand in a commendably short time. A Ford sedan, full of them, 2-1 motorcycles and a patrol wagon and about 8 in it and a few reporters. They began bagging a tower, front door, flashlights shot, streaks of gleam up and down the walls, across the yard, down the walk, between our house and Bodwell's. Open up! Cried a hoarse voice. We are men from headquarters. I wanted to go down and let them in since there they were. But mother wouldn't hear of it. You haven't a stitch on, she pointed out. You would catch your death. I would the towel around me again. Finally, the cops put their shoulders to our big heavy front door with its thick beveled glass and broke it in. I could hear a rending of wood and a splash of glass on the floor of the hall. The lights played all over the living room and crisscrossed nervously in the dining room, stabbed into hallways, shot up the front stairs and finally up the back. They caught me standing in my towel at the top. A heavy policeman bounded up the steps. Who are you? He demanded. I live here, I said. The officer in charge reported to mother, "No sign of nobody, lady," he said. "Must have got away. What did he like?" "There were two or three of them," mother said, "whooping and carrying on, slamming doors." "Funny," said the cops. "All yeah, windows and doors were locked on the inside, tight as a thick." Downstairs, we could hear the tramping of the other police. Police were all over the place. Doors were yanked open. Drawers were yanked open. Windows were shot up and pulled down. Furniture fell with dull thumps. A half dozen policemen emerged out of the darkness of the front hallway upstairs. They began to ransack the floor, pulled beds away from walls, tore clothes off hooks in the closets, pulled suitcases and boxes off shelves. One of them found an old zither that Roy had won in a pool tournament. "Looky here, Joe," he said, strumming it with a big paw. The cop named Joe took it and turned it over. "What is it?" he asked me. "It is an old zither, guinea pig used to sleep on," I said. It was true that a pet guinea pig we once had would never sleep anywhere except on the zither. "But I should never have said so." Joe and the other cop looked at me a long time. They put the zither back on the shelf. "No sign of nothing," said the cop, who had first spoken to mother. The lady seemed hysterical. They all nodded but said nothing. They looked at me. In the small silence, we all heard a creaking in the attic. Grandfather was turning over in bed. "What is that?" snapped Joe. Five or six cops sprang for the attic door. Before I could intervene or explain, I realized that it would be bad if they burst in on Grandfather unannounced or even announced. He was going through a phase in which he believed that General Meade's men, under steady hammering by Stonewall Jackson, were beginning to retreat and even desert. When I got to the attic, things were pretty confused. Grandfather had evidently jumped to a conclusion that the police were deserters from Meade's army, trying to hide away in his attic. He bounded out of bed, wearing a long flannel nightgown, over long woolen pants, a nightcap, and a leather jacket around his chest. The cops must have realized at once that the indignant white-haired old man belonged to the house, but they had no chance to say so. "Back, ye cowardly dog," roared Grandfather. "Back it, the lion's egg. Got him, lily-livered cattle," with that. He fetched the officer who found the zither a flat handed smack alongside his head that sent him sprawling. The others beat a retreat, but not enough. Grandfather grabbed Zither's gun from its holster and let fly. The report seemed to crack. The rafter smoke filled the attic. The cop cursed and shot his hand to his shoulder. Somehow, we all finally got downstairs again and locked the door against the old gentleman. He fired once or twice more in the darkness and then went back to bed. That was Grandfather. I explained to Joe, out of breath, "He thinks you are a deserter." "I will say he does," said Joe. The cops were reluctant to leave without getting their hand on somebody. Besides grandfather, the night had been distinctively a defeat for them. Furthermore, they obviously didn't like the layout. Something looked, and I can see their viewpoint. Phony. They began to poke into things again. A reporter, wispy man, came up to me. I had put on one of mother's dress. Not being able to find anything else, the reporter looked at me with mingled suspicion and interest. Just what the hell is the real lowdown here? But, he asked, I decided to be frank with him. We had ghost, I said. He gazed at me a long time, as if I were slot machine into which he had, without results, dropped a coin. Then he walked away. The cops followed him. The one grandfather shot holding his now bandaged arm, cursing and blaspheming, I'm gonna get my gun back from the old bird, said the zither cop. Yeah, said Joe. You? And who else? I told them. I would bring it to the station house the next day. What was the matter with the one policeman? Mother asked. After they had gone, grandfather shot him. I said, what for? She demanded. I told her he was a deserter of all things, said mother. He was such a nice looking young man. Grandfather was fresh as a daisy and full of jokes at breakfast next morning. We thought at first he had forgotten all about what had happened, but he hadn't. Over his third cup of coffee, he glared at Herman and me. What was the idea of all them cops tarrying, hooting around the house last night? He demanded. None of you bothered to leave a water bottle beside my bed. Do you ever realize what it cost for a thirsty man to look for water in the dining room last night? He had us there. Thank you.